Common Council meeting to order. I invite you to please, well, actually, item two on our agenda this evening is the roll call. All members are present with the exception of Alderperson Rayom, who may be joining us late. I haven't heard anything of the order or the contrary, so. Following the roll call on our agenda this evening is the presentation of colors by the Wisconsin Rapids Police Department. I invite you to please stand for the presentation of colors. Please join us in the Pledge of Allegiance. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. I invite you to follow with the silent prayer. Thank you. Item number five on the agenda this evening is a reading of the minutes of the previous meeting. I'll allow Tom to come forward and get settled for just a minute. And while Tom's coming forward, I'll entertain a motion on the minutes of the previous meeting. We have a motion by Koth to approve. Is there a second?
Second.
A second by Furkey. Any further discussion? Any additions or corrections to the minutes? Hearing none. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? That motion carried unanimously. Item number six on the agenda this evening is the explanation of the visitor speaking procedure. Individuals wishing to address the body may do so only on agenda items appearing before us this evening, in which you'll be allowed to speak after being acknowledged by a council member, in which you'll be invited to the podium and be allowed to speak for no longer than 5 minutes. We ask you to introduce yourself and state your address for the record, name and address for the record. We're going to move past my report for a moment. We're going to move into the administration of the oath of office for Police Officer Michael Berger. invite him forward, please.
Please raise your right hand and repeat after me. I, Michael Berger.
I, Michael Berger.
Having been appointed as a police officer.
Having been appointed as a police officer.
For the city of Wisconsin Rapids.
For the city of Wisconsin Rapids.
Swear that I will support.
Swear that I will support.
The Constitution of the United States.
The Constitution of the United States.
And the Constitution of the state of Wisconsin.
And the Constitution of the state of Wisconsin.
And will faithfully and impartially.
And will faithfully and impartially.
Discharge the duties of said office.
Discharge the duties of said office.
To the best of my ability.
To the best of my ability.
So help me God.
So help me God.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
For the moment, we're going to move past my report as I'm having difficulties locating it, and I thought I had a paper copy with me. So maybe we'll see what happens, spare you that tonight possibly. Item number 9 on the agenda this evening is a report of the Planning Commission held on January 9th concerning. The Planning Commission met at 4 p.m. on January 9th in the first floor conference room of City Hall. Members present included myself, Fran Aaron, Shane Burkhart, Joe Terry, Lee Tao, and Alderperson Todd Furkey. Member absent was Tim Burkhauser. Others in attendance are included Adam Tagan, Charlie Handy of Civic Tech, Jim Lucas, and Rick Murdan. The meeting was called to order at 4:04 p.m. Item 1 was update and discussion on the zoning rewrite project with Civic Tech. The commission discussed area and minimum size requirements for the proposed chapter sections 11.09.08 and 11.09.10 as they relate to cottage housing. The recommendation was to include a category that would allow housing of 500 to 800 feet. The commission completed their review of the draft land use matrix, which covers where uses are permitted, conditional uses are not permitted. Item 2 is adjournment. Motion by Aaron, second by Furkey to adjourn at 5:30 p.m., and that motion carried unanimously. Council members, what are your wishes regarding item number 9 as the report of the Planning Commission meeting? Motion by Dolan, is there a second?
Second.
Second by Zerflew. Any discussion on the report? Seeing no requests to speak, all in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Item carried unanimously. Item 10 this evening is standing council committee reports. Item A is the Finance and Property Committee meeting held March 14th concerning.
Thank you, Your Honor, fellow council members, those here present, those watching at home, as well as city staff. Please bear with me tonight. It's quite a lengthy report. Finance and Property Committee met at 5 p.m. on March 14, 2017, in the first floor conference room here at City Hall. All members were present. A list of all others present is on file in the clerk's office. The meeting was called to order by Chairperson Dolan at 5 p.m. Item 2, consider adoption of a chronic nuisance ordinance. It was moved by Dolan, seconded by Zerflew to approve adoption of the chronic nuisance ordinance as presented by city staff. That motion carried. Item 3, consider various requests from Wisconsin Rapids Rafters for improvements to Witter Field. Agenda item A of that 3, request approval for the Rafters to remove some bleacher seating and replace with 64 stadium box seats with a bar rail. The Rafters would pay for the seating and bar rail. It was moved by Dolan, seconded by Zerflew to approve the request by the Rafters to remove some bleacher seating and replace it with 64 stadium box seats with a bar rail. The Rafters will pay for the seating and bar rail. Repainting of the seating area must be done completely and not just spot painting. The Parks and Building Supervisor must approve the painting plan as well as the welding plan. Painting and welding must be done by professionals. That motion carried. B, request for city crews to assist in the installation of stadium seats. This request was rescinded by General Manager John Fanta, but I did tell him I would help. Item C, request the city apply for a grant from the Northwoods League Foundation for the installation of a cover for the accessible seating area. It was moved by Dolan, seconded by Zerflew to approve the request that the city apply for a grant from the Northwoods League Foundation for the installation of a cover for the accessible seating area at Witter Field. That motion carried. Item D, request approval to install a video board next to the scoreboards at Rafter's expense. It was moved by Zerflu and seconded by Heff to approve the request to install a video board next to the scoreboard at Rafter's expense. That motion and carry. Item E, request approval for the Wisconsin Rapids Rafters to sponsor a craft beer fest at Witter Field. The tentative date is September 9th. It was moved by Zerflu and seconded by Heff to approve the request by the Wisconsin Rapids Rafters to sponsor a craft beer fest at Witter Field, provided a $250 fee is paid to the city. That motion carried. Item F, request that the city assist in the cost of leveling off, regrading, and residing the infield and part of the outfield. It was moved by Dolan, seconded by Heff to approve the request by the Rafters that the city assist in the cost of leveling off, regrading, and residing the infield and part of the outfield, the city's contribution not to exceed $10,000. The Rafters shall be responsible for funding the remaining costs. The Rafters may solicit from other field users or organizations contributions towards this project. A local landscape firm will assist with sod cutting and removal under the direction of Ball Diamond Fine Sports Turf LLC, who will be responsible for the laser grading, finishing sod, and infield mix. City crews will assist, if available, with removing sod and can provide materials, sand, etc., if available. These field improvements can be funded from the Witter Field outlay budget. That motion carried. Agenda item 4, consideration of a Class B beer and Class B liquor license application by Amy Friday, doing business at the Square Bar located at 210 Johnson Street, Wisconsin Rapids. It was moved by Hep and seconded by Dolan to approve Class A beer and Class B liquor license application by Amy Friday, doing business at the Square Bar located at 210 Johnson Street. That motion carried. Agenda item 5, review and consider rate adjustments for non-resident and contractor compost site users. It was moved by Zerflu and seconded by Hep to approve rate adjustments for non-resident and contractor compost site users to $50 for non-resident passes and $150 for two contractor passes and $25 for each additional contractor pass. That motion carried. Item 6, consider for approval quotes to purchase a 4x4 pickup truck to replace a 2008 Chevy van in the fire department. It was moved by Hep and seconded by Zerflu to approve the quote from Scafidi to purchase a 4x4 pickup truck with a 6-foot bed to replace a 2008 Chevy van. The van can be disposed of by sale or trade-in at the fire department's discretion following city policies. Excuse me, that motion carried. Item 7, consider for approval the purchase of a new 911 alerting system for fire station number 1 and number 2. It was moved by Zerflu and seconded by Dolan to approve the purchase of a new 911 alerting system for fire station 1 and number 2 from U.S. Digital for a total amount of $70,960.54. That motion carried. Item 8, consider for approval of a 2016 transfer and revenue appropriation resolution. It was moved by Dolan and seconded by Hep to approve of the 2016 transfer and revenue appropriation resolution as presented. That motion carried. Item 9, consider for approval a resolution amending the 2017 budget. It was moved by Hep and seconded by Zerflu to approve the resolution amending the 2017 budget as presented. That motion carried. Item 10, preliminary review of the 2017-2018 liquor, beer, wine license application. The submitted 2017-2018 liquor, beer, wine license applications were reviewed. Item 11, beverage operator license applications. It was moved by Zerflu and seconded by Dolan to approve of the beverage operator license applications as presented. That motion carried. Item 12, audit of the bills. It was moved by Zerflu and seconded by Hep to approve check number 66638 to 66948 and manual check numbers 0099214 to 099228. That motion carried. Item 13, an open session. Committee will vote to go into closed session under section 19.85, para 1, para E of the Wisconsin statutes, which reads, quote, deliberating or negotiating the purchase of public properties, the investing of public funds, or conducting other specified public business whenever competitive or bargaining reasons require closed sessions, end of quote. It was moved by Dolan, seconded by Zerflu to go into closed session pursuant to sections 19.85, para 1, para E of the Wisconsin statutes. Roll call vote taken. All members voted in the affirmative. That motion carried. Part A, continuing in closed session, the committee will discuss negotiations regarding the purchase of properties in the downtown area. In closed session, the committee discussed negotiations regarding the purchase of properties in the downtown area. Item B, the committee may take action regarding negotiation parameters in closed session and may adjourn in closed session. Agenda item 14, the committee adjourned in closed session. With that, I would look for adoption of these minutes.
Wow.
Motion to approve item number 10A, Finance and Property Committee meeting. Is there a, by Dolan, is there a second?
I'll second.
Second by Zerflu. Move into discussion. Are there any requests to speak on the matter? Alderperson Koth, you're first. Can you make sure your microphone's on, Steve? Thank you.
Prior to approving this motion, can I speak on item number 2? Or possibly even hold it out for discussion?
Whichever your preference.
I'd like to hold out item number 2.
Okay. So we've got a item number 2 held out. Are there any other, Alderperson Rayom, you're next.
Thank you, Your Honor. Quick question and a comment, I guess.
Sure.
On item, both on item 3. The rescind that was made on B, was that also including A? I assume it's A and B.
My understanding is they were going to continue to proceed doing the bleacher seating, but without any city
Just,
staff
so it's
support.
Just B?
Yeah,
okay.
Right.
All right.
So
okay.
A stays, yeah.
Okay, all right. Well, I'm glad I asked that.
Yeah, yeah.
All right. And just, I guess, the comment on F is the redoing of the field in that there, Witter Field. It's a project thing that's it's years overdue. That should have been done a long, long time ago, even before the Rafters came to town. It should have been done when the Legion team was playing there, you know, a long time ago. So I'm glad it's being done.
Thanks for the comment. Are there any other items? Alderperson Dolan.
Just a point of order, Tom, though. I think that was actually an advantage for the pitchers because it's higher, I believe, so.
Are there any other requests to speak? Not disputing that. Item 2 has been held. Yep, that leaves the balance of the report. All right, we'll move into a vote. All in favor of approving the report with the exception of item number 2, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Passes unanimously. We'll move back to item number 2, the consideration of adoption of a chronic nuisance ordinance. Are there any requests? Well, the floor is open, I guess. There's no motion on the floor. Go ahead, Alderperson Dolan.
I'd like to yield my time if I could.
Yes.
Says push. Am I on?
You got it.
All right. I'm going to be brief. Recognizing of
please introduce yourself with your address as well.
Yes. Kevin White. I live in Grand Rapids. I do have a property on 7th Street, on 12th Street, and Baker Street. My address, if you want it for the record, is 3410 Deer Road, Grand Rapids. I would like to ask the council to vote no and send the ordinance back for legal review. I would like to note, though, right away that we, I appreciate very much the changes that have been done over the last year. I mean, we're looking at a much different ordinance than we were looking at a year ago. There's been a lot of changes. And also, I'd like to recognize and appreciate the many property owners, including members of the local Property Owners Association that had a part in this and participated in many meetings over the last year. The area of my concern from a legal standpoint is it's possible that this ordinance does not follow, follow law that requires exceptions for persons with disabilities. I did not see that noted in the ordinance. That's one of the things that we have to abide by when it comes to the Fair Housing Act. In addition, the ordinance may force property owners to choose between fines at the local level or fines for violating state and federal anti-discrimination laws, including the Fair Housing Act. If you want to see where I'm coming from, you could refer to the Agricultural Trade and Consumer Protection Agency chapter 135 at the end. Also, chapter 704 of Wisconsin State Statute 704.17 with regards to proving with evidence what we were doing when we would proceed with an abatement plan with regards to eviction or closing out the tenancy. Otherwise, as a property owner, I have participated with other local government agencies in giving second chances to those in need. And I spoke, my wife spoke with the director of the Family Center today, and there's a quote from her that we caught, and she said, there could be unintended consequences of this proposed ordinance for a lot of good people. And one of the risks that she identified is that for victims with limited resources looking for second chances, they already face a bunch of challenges, meaning by they I mean the Family Center. And it seems like the majority of that is placed in historically studies by Berkeley and others, ACLU, have found that these type of ordinances place homeless women and children in a disadvantage in finding affordable housing. So I guess that would be a personal concern that I have, is we're trying to work with people, and these type of ordinances give us very limited options on what we can do. That's all.
Thank you, Attorney Schill. Did you have anything to comment on the matter?
Right, I guess I'm not unclear of the, you mentioned some legal, I guess the fair housing as it relates to us and landlords, or you're talking how it impacts you and your treatment of your tenants? Because this is simply a fees for excessive service to a property. It doesn't involve, I guess I'm unclear of the nexus between the fair housing, and this ordinance.
Well, what happens, I mean, basically we have to follow state law, and the statute says
right.
that even if there's a conflict between what you're mandating and the state law, we have to follow state law. And
right.
So
what are we requiring of you that's in conflict?
Basically what we've shown, or what studies have shown, is that people do more extreme vetting, property owners do more extreme vetting or review of those that are applying to mitigate the risk of maybe not following the ordinance.
Okay. Well.
Of the tenant not following the ordinance.
Right. So you're saying by the city basically saying to the landlords, you know, you might get charged for these extra services, then you in turn might do, you're more careful with the people you take in, and then unintentionally that might be bring you into the realm of violating fair housing or some of the protections under ATCP and the landlord statute. I guess I'm, because this doesn't, you know, this isn't about people, you know, or landlords even. I mean, it's about the property owners and what happens. So I guess I'm just trying to understand the legal, you know, the how the two relate.
Yeah, I think it actually is about people, mm-hmm. is what my point is.
But we're not doing right.
I know, but that's the end. What I'm talking about is the people.
Right.
What this ordinance does is it's basically a method called third-party policing, where Milwaukee, many other places have done these types of ordinances, and it's putting on us, which we're already property owners, especially landlords, mm-hmm. are already partnering with the police in many different mm-hmm. ways,
right.
because obviously we have
right.
the incentive
right.
to maintain a clean property.
Right.
I guess my point is that we are forced to make judgments. In other words, if someone approaches me from a standpoint of, I want a second chance, I have to use the Fair Housing Act laws to protect myself and to do to pick that tenant within the best, you know, policies that I can. And what this type of an ordinance does, I'm not talking about myself, but I'm talking about typically the result is that property owners in general are more careful. And that ends up having an effect on that population.
Okay.
I'm not saying that I personally am going to violate an act based on that. I'm just saying that you tend to mitigate the risk. We are the professionals. In court, we have to be the professional.
But the ordinance itself is not...
I understand that.
Illegal or unconstitutional or doing that, but it's a consequence. You're saying it's a consequence of what we're doing.
Yes. I think the only legal question is the first one I brought up from a standpoint of disability. Did you include that? I didn't see it in there. Maybe I missed it. Mm-hmm. But there are definitely going to be calls, and we certainly do have tenants or citizens that would fit in that area.
Okay, so you mean a call, so the tenant is disabled, and you're saying, I guess I'm trying to figure out where would the accommodation
Is there any recognition in the ordinance that a disabled person might not be in their full faculties when they're making frivolous calls or something along those lines? And that then, is there any mitigating circumstances when it comes to that so that we're not punishing a property owner for someone that doesn't have the ability to make those decisions?
Well, I think every day the police make those judgment calls in dealing with people and who complains, you know, making complaints and so on. I guess I understand what you're saying, and I think there's some discretion, and obviously when we talk about an abatement plan or even the circumstances resulting in, you know, the nuisance activities, I think obviously, you know, this ordinance is about, you know, right now you're not getting any notice. This ordinance is about giving you notice and then also sitting down with you and having an abatement plan, you telling us information and us sharing information with you. And I think, you know, I think in that exercise, you know, it will be a better thing. Obviously, if it gets to the point where you're being charged for services, you're not going to like that. But I think that's kind of the last resort. I think what the police department, and I know Chief Johns, they want to stress working together, and this is another way to work together. And but I appreciate your comments on, I just wanted to have a little discussion on the legal part of it. Thank you.
Alderperson Koth, you're next.
I'd like to, I'd like to recognize Dean Ramsden.
Thanks, Steve. Let me speak, and thanks to everybody here for, I know we've been laboring on this for a long time. Dean Ramsden, I live in Rome, 455 Duffers Trail, but I do own property here in Wisconsin Rapids. I am part of the local landlord association. I also serve as a past president on the Wisconsin Apartment Association, which we serve hundreds of landlords throughout Wisconsin. And the chronic nuisance laws are starting to pop up throughout the state. And landlords are, fighting against them, no different than many cities have tried the inspection programs, and it took the state to do Act 176 to overrule that, which I think is going to happen here with this chronic nuisance law, because it ultimately comes back to us, the landlord, for bad actors. And I just want to add on to Kevin's point about the females or disabilities or things like that. There's cases, there's times when the police are called on domestic cases. And I can think of a recent case that I just had not too long ago, and the police were called on that, and it's going to create, the family center is going to create more, us landlords are going to get tougher on these situations, we're going to evict quicker on it, it's going to clog up the court systems even more. It's really not going after, I understand why the city wants to do this, you're ultimately coming after the landlords for that financial piece, but we don't have a lot of control in that. We were told there was 22 calls. That's excessive. 22 calls is very excessive. So I just want to read one little piece here, because your vote tonight will trigger what's going to happen in the state. And Senator Teston's been abreast of this, and so has Krug, and several others. We just met there in Madison last week, Wednesday. So there's eight things that we're looking at, and of course, this is one of them, and it's real quick. It says municipalities more and more are using nuisance laws to force property owners to evict tenants who have too many police calls. Too many police calls vary from city to city, but landlord-tenant law is a civil process, and a landlord must follow the law. A landlord simply cannot be forced to evict a tenant at the will of the local police department. All too often, the police fail or are unwilling to cite people for illegal behavior. Landlords are being told by the Department of Housing and Urban Development and the Department of Justice that they can be sued for discrimination for improperly using public record and for using tenants' public record that does not relate to the place in which they live, as a detriment for not renting to somebody. The holding of a property owner for illegal actions of another is wrong. We are suggesting that this is a statewide concern and should be addressed by the legislator. So, I don't know if you totally understand where we're coming from, but it's an ordinance that's going to put more pressure on us and potentially even cost us more financially. And we're just going to put that back onto the tenant. I think that's where Kevin was talking about. There's going to get people are going to get caught in the system, whether it's with the family center or whether they're disabled, because there's a bad actor. Maybe it's somebody that, a friend that come over and is in dealing drugs or whatever they're doing. But it's going to affect that person that we're renting to. And the ultimate is we're going to sit down and do an abatement plan, and the bottom line is we're going to evict them. And where I have problems is if you look at this chronic nuisance ordinance, it holds us, that property, for 180 days. So if somebody causes a problem and we abate and we do all the things, and then all of a sudden they move out for 180 days, correct me if I'm wrong, that property is still deemed like a chronic nuisance property.
No, if you've complied with the abatement plan and have made reasonable efforts to stop, I mean, that's kind of your safe harbor. If you've done that, then we're not going to charge you for the next one.
Okay, so what's that 180 days in there? What does that mean?
Well, if you don't abide by the abatement plan,
yep,
and don't make reasonable efforts, then if you have another one within the 180 days, then you're going to get charged for that next call to your.
So it takes 180 days or 6 months to clean up. If we had a bad actor, what happens if a new person would come in and all of a sudden they start dealing drugs? So it's mm-hmm. that first offense. What happens in that case?
Well, like I said, we look at your abatement plan and what reasonable efforts you've made. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I technically, if that's your fourth call within that amount of time, you could be subject to the charge for the next call. I would like to think that when you meet with the police department and do the abatement plan, and when that next notice comes or that next action comes, that if you explain, well, I just got this person out, and yes, now this person is a bad actor, but now I'm willing to, you know, these are the things I'm going to do with this person, mm-hmm. that perhaps you're not going to get charged. But technically speaking, you know, it's with the property, it's not with the tenant, you know, it counts.
Right, and it's with
notices
the property.
Against the property.
We wish it would be with the tenant.
Right, I know you do.
So that we can, and that, you know, I think that, you know, I understand why you're doing this, but I think that's again why it's going to push the state to come in, and because what's happening is all these different cities are coming up with different chronic nuisance laws, and there's no set standard. So I don't, you know, I think for the majority of us, it's not going to be a problem. We are going to cooperate. We do want to get rid of the bad actors. I mean, don't take me wrong. I understand why we're doing this, but at the end of the day, we still don't want to be caught in the spoke of the wheels. Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Are there any other requests to speak? Alderperson Zerflew, you're next.
This might be more for Chief Johns, but there was a comment made about something said by someone at the family center. Now, the way I read this, there's exemptions for any domestic violence, any sexual assault, any stalking. But if you're calling to report as a victim or a complainant, there's not going to be any action against you. And under any circumstances, would a victim reporting something fall under this ordinance?
Well, I can't say all the time, but for, and I wanted to comment on the last speaker, domestic abuse is not a strike. If somebody calls in a domestic abuse situation, that is not one of the activities that would count as a strike against that property. And the idea, he also mentioned if he should evict a current tenant and start with a new tenant within that 180 days. That's something, yes, he tried to make that proper correction, and we would deal with that, and we'd start fresh with the new tenant. I just wanted to clarify those points. If, I just want to, just so we're all clear how all the ordinance reads, does not include activities, behaviors, or conduct that result in a call for assistance made by the owner or occupant requesting law enforcement services related to any of the following. And it states domestic abuse, sexual assault, and stalking. But also if there's other activity out there that they're calling for, a window peeker or, you know, yeah, somebody outside the property they feel, that's not going to count as a strike, no.
I just wanted to make sure we were clear on that. And also for the frivolous calls issue, there shouldn't be, if someone, we dealt with this a year ago when this first came up, but there was a property owner from my district who was here who wanted this ordinance to apply to a neighbor who kept calling on him. Completely frivolous, imagined ordinance violations. But if there's no action taken by the police department or the ordinance officer or whoever, then it's not going to qualify as your first or second violation or anything under this ordinance.
That's correct.
That was really all I had. Thank you.
Are there any other requests to speak? Alderperson Koth, you're next.
I don't necessarily oppose the reasoning behind a chronic nuisance ordinance. I see a lot of the problems that we have in this town, and I believe the chronic nuisance ordinance is designed to get the nuisances out of town or get rid of the nuisance or to quiet the areas that we're having problems with. But I really do believe, as the landlords have said, if you have a person that's being a nuisance, you have to hold the person that's creating the problem responsible. It doesn't seem reasonable to hold somebody else responsible for the actions of somebody else. The first gentleman that spoke, Kevin, I think I understood clearly what he was saying, that going forward with this, if this ordinance passes as it is, every landlord in this city, before they rent to somebody, they're going to jump on CCAP, and they're going to pull up what they got, and they're going to look at it and say, well, okay, you've had 10 disorderly conducts in a year. I'm not going to rent to you. Disorderly conduct could be anything from somebody standing out in their lawn shouting to maybe a minor altercation between two people. A lot of these people are going to show up at the landlord's office to apply for a rental property, and they're going to put on the facade of, we're good people, we pay our bills, we had problems in the past, we want a second chance, we're going to change now. And the landlord may rent to them, giving them that second chance, and the problems aren't going to change, and the landlord is going to be stuck with these people, and the landlord is going to have to incur the expense and the time to go through the eviction process. I don't have a problem with the ordinance, but I really do believe we need to hold the individuals accountable for their actions. If that means issuing them municipal citations for disorderly conduct and having it go through that action, or merely holding the individuals responsible for the police time that we want to bill them for. I think by holding that accountable, that is how we will get rid of the nuisance in our city.
Thank you. Randy, did you want to comment on that?
Yes, please. Part of the problem on that, we are making the arrests, we are writing the citations, and a lot of these people aren't changing their ways. And what this does is gives us a little more power. Now we have the property owner involved trying to help us make the proper corrections. Because imagine if you're living next to one of these properties where you have to deal with this day to day, whatever. And we're coming there, we're doing our part, and numerous occasions, And I gave the example last week in the meeting. Right now we're dealing with a couple properties. One is owner-occupied, and it's obviously not having any effect. One is a rental, but we have been to those two properties 22 and 19 times. Again, making arrests, writing citations, and it's not having any effect. We're putting in a lot of time on specific properties. And this just gives us another tool as a way to help combat the problem, correct the problem. But we're looking at from the eyes of the people that have to live next to these properties, how it affects their property values, how it affects their way of life.
Thank you. Are there any other requests to speak? Alderperson Kellogg, you're next.
I just want to comment on one of the speakers where they talked about the changes that were made with regard to this ordinance, and I'm pleased that those changes were made and we went back to the drawing boards. And I want to thank the city staff, the police department, and the landlords who were involved with that. The one comment I like to make is that if this does pass, that the police department come back to the common council this time next year and not identify property, but how many ordinances were identified, how many were remedied, and the total fees as a result. So we have a sense of the impact of this ordinance if it was passed.
Are there any other requests to speak? Alderperson Raomir next.
Just a question. Randy, I don't know how many rentals we have in town, but say out of 100, how many of that percentage would there be that there's a problem with? You know, I mean, are we looking at 25% that the PD has a problem with, or are we writing this ordinance for 2% of the rentals in town, or are we writing this for 25% of the rentals in town? Just for my curiosity.
I would say right now from our perspective, from police department, it's probably a very small number, just a handful. I would say probably easily less than 10. I can't be more specific on that right now because we aren't tracking it, but I would say it's a very fairly small number.
It's also important to point out that it's not just doesn't just apply to residential properties, right? It's commercial properties, it's commercial establishments that we're constantly making, you know, calls for service downtown and others as well. So I just want to make that clarification that this is not pinpointed to residential properties, but I'm glad you raised the question. Are there any other requests to speak? Alderperson Stack.
Thank you, Your Honor. To those present with this ordinance, are we talking about properties that are, I'm going to say, locally owned, like Mr. Smith and Mr. Ramsden? It was Smith, wasn't it? White, I'm sorry. Any knowledge which way, if it's local landlords and property owners or absentee, anything like that showed up in the study and discussion?
I'm not sure if Randy can weigh in or even Adam. I know Adam's department deals with a number of the other components of the case. I don't know where they mail their notices to. I mean, we know that we've got a good mixture of absentee landlords and local property owners. My gut would tell me one thing, but I'll let these guys talk on another.
Well, I was just going to say, I would say the vast majority, I'm sure, are locally owned. So what we deal with, the owners are probably more local. However, I do know of one instance in the past where the owner was actually lived out of state. So,
Adam, did you have anything?
No, I would probably
follow Randy's lead on it. It's going to be a wide variety. It's not necessarily whether it's a local or not as the state or city landlord. It's generally a wide variety. One in particular comes to mind that's an owner-occupied one, so obviously that would be local.
Okay. Another item then is, as presented, Adam, have you heard from the state or other groups about this ordinance and their reflection upon it, as Mr. White stated?
Specific to Mr. White's comments, as far as whether or not it adequately addresses...
State action.
Okay. No, I have not heard from any other communities on that. We did reach out to other communities just to see how they were utilizing the ordinance as we were doing our research, but not outreach to the state.
And did the association that you're a part of, I'm sure you're a part of some developers association, something like that for municipal employees, municipal developers, administrators like yourself, have they commented on anything?
No, as Mr. Ramsden noted, this is a community by community issue right now. There is not a single, you know, model ordinance or anything like that that is able to be accessed right now.
Okay. So then for us to pass an ordinance tonight would mean that we're setting a standard that could be changed with the state action. Is that correct?
Well, I would defer to Sue for a formal legal opinion, but I guess the way I would look at it, it's no different than any other ordinance that the city would pass, whether it's a zoning ordinance, whether it's a property maintenance code. Anything can be adjusted by the state legislature if they so choose, if they feel that it's necessary. So.
Sure enough. Okay.
And I think state preemption has happened on any number of issues. One was raised, and that was the rental inspection program. I mean, the state legislature in the last number of years is notorious. The smoking ordinance, right? Statewide smoking ban. I mean, there's a number of precedents set by the state to grab power from the locals and saying what's best for the state versus the local community. So I would think it's probably not out of the question that any number of topics would come before the legislature if certain interest groups continue to lobby their legislators and you know, make their representatives take action.
I guess I see on something like this a hardship against the property owner. You know, the property owner, I would believe in most instances, has done as best as he could to have within his property responsible individuals. But you just do not know who you're going to get until it's rented and there's a history presented. So my vote tonight would be against this ordinance. It's only because it provides a hardship to the owner. And I don't see anything well, the person who gets in trouble is going to get in trouble, right? You're going to, no matter what you do, you're going to be back there again until he gets kicked out. Then you kick him out of his place and he moves to someplace else, either in town or another community or whatnot. I mean, they're a troublemaker. Let's call it that. They're just a troublemaker, and they don't know right from wrong, and they don't know good from bad, and they're going to be a pain wherever they go. So why do we want to burden the owner of the property with this? Thank you.
Are there any other Alderperson Zerflu? And I think Alderperson Raomi also wanted to speak too. Zerflu, go ahead.
I'll be brief as usual, but I do want to just make sure that we understand that this is for property owners. This ordinance applies to me. It applies to all of us that own property. I recognize the issues that the landlords are worried about. I know that that's fair for them to have concerns about this. And however you decide to vote, of course, is that's up to you. But I just want to make sure that we understand, like this just applies to property owners. It's not designed for rental houses or anything like that. So.
Thank you. Alderperson Ram, did you say you wanted to speak again? I thought I caught
you in
the corner of my eye.
I was and I wasn't, but I will. What the heck? Thanks, Joel, for that. But this doesn't take effect till July 1st in here. Is that correct then?
My understanding,
okay.
Yep.
How long do we have to have notice for Sue for something? for this to take notice, or to take effect?
I guess I'm not sure what...
Does that have to pass tonight to take effect on July 1st? I mean, right. I'm leaning how... I hear what Jim's saying, obviously.
Well, if you passed it tonight, it would take effect on July 1st. I mean...
If it's not passed tonight.
If it's not passed tonight, then it's not going to take effect.
If it came, no, obviously, I mean, but if it came back to... If it came back...
Oh, I see. If you...
If it was revised or something.
The ordinance could say any effective date. I guess we chose that date to allow... we're working on the kind of a more of an automated notification system, and just kind of working through the bugs on that.
If
plus,
it was
just
revised,
allow people time, so...
If it was revised and came back in a month or...
You could...
I mean, with July... Would it still be... Could it still be effective July?
It could.
Or I'm just asking how long, to be noticed, how far out does it have to go to be effective?
Well,
2 months or what? What's the notice to the public?
There's no notice to the public. Actually, the notice to the public actually comes after there has to be, after an ordinance is approved, then the notice goes in the paper. No, I think it would just be a matter of, if this didn't have the date of July 1 in, and it just said, it usually would say it passes upon approval and publication, usually that's 3 days after. So we pushed it out. It wouldn't need to be pushed out that far. It could be pushed out farther. I think we just allowed a little time to make sure that the notification process was sound, and so we asked for just a couple of months to do that, and then just to get people oriented with it.
All right. Thanks.
Are there any other requests to speak? Alderperson Koth, you're next.
I think moving forward, we want to encourage people to bring their business to Wisconsin Rapids, and we're looking at this ordinance as it affects property owners, not specific to rental properties. So we're saying if somebody wants to come to town and build a restaurant or build a bar, okay, we got enough of them, but if you, another one like a bar and grill, we're saying bring your business to Wisconsin Rapids. But if you get that one person, I think Alderperson Stack identified correctly, has a troublemaker. You get that one troublemaker that comes to your business and they cause problems in your business and the police have to come there, we're going to bill you for the police service instead of billing the person that's causing the problem. That's why I'm still against this. I think you build a person, and if you can't get the money out of the person that you build, you look and see if our municipality has the power to run a tax intercept on them, and you take and garnish their state income tax refund, and you make them pay the bill. That's all.
Are there any further requests to speak? Alderperson Kellogg, you're next.
The problem I have is basically we're talking about, at first we're talking about landlords and property owners. The problem I have is, what about the residents that live next to these properties? I mean, we're always talking about, I have some people in my area that just want to move because they may be living next to some of these properties, and they have to be corrected. And I think the committee went back and resolved some significant points, and that's why I asked for a report this time next year that there might only be five. We're spending all this time on five properties, five landlords, whomever, and we're spending all this time. And I have to think of the other constituents I have, other than the people that might be directly affected in this. In fact, directly affected in this are the residents that live next to these properties. So I think this is long overdue. I've asked for it for 3 months, and I think we should do it. And if in this time next year, in March, we find that this ordinance needs to be changed, let's change it. But I'm in favor of it because I have to think of all my other constituents that live around these properties.
Alderperson Kellogg, we don't have a motion on the floor, so I want to make that clarification. If you wanted to make a motion, you had the floor. Unless there's others, I don't see any other requests to speak. Oh, Alderperson Dolan, you're next.
I'd like to make a motion to approve. We're all voting on it, so why don't we make a motion to approve.
We have a motion to approve by Dolan and a second by Furkey, I think I heard. Is that correct? Any further discussion? Seeing no further requests to speak, all in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Nay.
Nay.
Opposed. We have two in the opposition. We can do a roll call vote. I didn't hear Stack. Dolan?
Nay.
All right, motion carried. Five ayes, three nays. We'll move on to the next item on our agenda this evening, which is item number 10B, the Public Works Committee meeting held March 7th. Alderperson Rehom, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Your Honor. Public Works Committee met at 6 p.m. on Tuesday, March 7th, 2017, in the first floor conference room at City Hall in Wisconsin Rapids. All members were present. A list of others present is on file in the clerk's office. Item one was the DPW report. The report was reviewed. Item two, review a resolution declaring it necessary for public safety and welfare that a sidewalk be installed on 12th Street South from Pepper Avenue to the expressway and on 10th Street South from Pepper Avenue to north of Wood Avenue. It was moved and seconded by Koth to approve a preliminary resolution declaring it necessary for public safety and welfare that a sidewalk be installed along 12th Street South from Pepper Avenue to the expressway and along 10th Street South from Pepper Avenue to north of Wood Avenue. The motion carried. Item three, consider street lighting upgrade on West Grand Avenue from high pressure sodium to LEDs. It was moved and seconded to partner with what the Water Works and Lighting Commission to upgrade the street lighting on West Grand Avenue from high pressure sodium to LEDs, and the motion carried. Item four was to review private right-of-way permit application for items such as private sprinklers in the street right-of-way. It was moved and seconded to approve a private right-of-way permit application for items such as private sprinklers in the street right-of-way in regards to the First Street project. The motion carried. Item five, consider amendment to extend MSA's service contract for on-call stormwater services from 2016 to 2017. It is moved and seconded to extend MSA's service contract for on-call stormwater services from 2016 to 2017, and the motion carried. Item six, review spillway maintenance and dredging activities related to the 1 mile creek impoundment located north of 2 Mile Avenue. It was moved and seconded to approve the draft memo written by city engineer to the 1 Mile Creek property owners regarding access and maintenance of the 1 Mile Creek situation. The motion carried. Item seven was to adjourn. It was motion and seconded to adjourn. The motion carried. Meeting adjourned at 6:53 p.m. And with that, Your Honor, I move for acceptance of the report.
A motion to approve by Rehom. Is there a second?
Second.
Second by Koth. Any discussion on the report? Are there any requests to speak? Seeing no requests to speak, we'll move into a vote. All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed, nay. Motion carried unanimously. Thank you. Item 11, miscellaneous reports. Item one, the clerk's office quarterly report. Item two, the Southwood County Board, Southwood County Airport Commission meetings held February 2nd and February March. Item three, the Ethics Board meeting held on February 9th. Item four, the Housing Authority meeting held January 25th. Item five, the McMillan Memorial Library Board of Trustees meeting held on January 15th. Item six, the Police and Fire Commission meetings held on February 8th and February 23rd. Item seven, the Park and Rec Commission meeting held on March 8th. And item eight, Fire Department monthly report for February. And item nine, the Wastewater Treatment Commission meeting held on March 1st. Council members, what are your wishes regarding those reports?
Move we accept the reports and place on file.
Motion to approve by Rehom and a second by Kellogg. Any discussion on the reports? Seeing no requests to speak, all in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carried unanimously. I was not able to, I think the internet connection up here is tough, so I'm going to send you my report via email. Item 12 is a referral of communication to committees. Are there any referrals? Alderperson Kellogg?
I have one for the Finance and Property Committee. McMillan Library has a unique initiative that they want to undertake with a public and private funds. The public funds would be the endowment of the library, so it'd be at no cost to the city. But their initiative is quite exciting because they want to install solar panels on the roof of the library, which in time will really cut the cost of electricity for the library and ultimately the city. So I'd like to have that on an agenda item for next month for finance and property.
Thank you. Are there any other referral of communication to committees? Seeing no further referral of communication to committees, I'd entertain a motion to adjourn.
Motion to adjourn.
Motion by Koth, second by Ferkey. All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Item passes. Thank you all for being here.